It does mention here that you have to register your board, and that means putting a sending me an email, putting your picture of your student ID card and the bottom of your Freedom K64 that has the code. But not just that, I also want you to type in your first name, last name, student ID, and the Freedom K64 serial number and your lab section. Also include that. You've got a course textbook and it's free. You just click on this and it goes through all the theory here, but there's a preface and some other stuff based on the getting started. And what you're going to find is that things like signed and unsigned conversions are in here, doing conversions, hex addition, hex subtraction, all this stuff is covered on these pages. So it shows you how to do all these things, how to do signed and unsigned. All this stuff is here, but there's also video. There's video lectures in the theory section, and there's week one video lectures that go through course overview. And then once you watch the video lectures for this and this, and you'll find that here is a folder, and under the folder, there's a bunch more videos. And what you want to do is once you watch those for week one, you're going to go to practice quizzes for week one. And you're going to work through these, which is going to be here's a quiz on the overview, here's a quiz in the preface, ASCII characters, number conversions, all this stuff. There's no credit for these, but it does practice up for chapter quizzes. And there will be chapter quizzes that are worth marks. The first week, you're going to be doing course overview and preface by yourself under the theory section. And you're going to be doing practice quizzes for those to get up to speed for week three, which is a chapter one quiz. The number conversions and all this other stuff that's here, we're going to be going through the first half of lab one. Now, you're not handing in labs. You're going to do the lab, and then based on what you did in the lab, you're going to have here in week two a lab one quiz. And it's going to be worth 2% of your mark. And once you're finished the following week, you're going to have a lab two quiz. But the first thing we want to get at is take a look under labs and go to lab one and let's take a look at that. That there's videos. This is a video link. This is a video link here too. And you just click on those. They launch a YouTube video and these can be auto translated, the closed captioning into any of 104 languages. Now, what you're going to do is you're going to take a binary number. Anything that's in bold is correct. You have to see are the octal here or in the hex version here, are they correct? And if they're not, you have to circle any errors that you find. And that's what you're going to do because when you get to the lab quiz, you might have this circle, this circle, this circle, and it says that's one option. Something like this one's wrong, that one's wrong, that one's wrong, which means you better have circled these and figure them out from the printout that you've got before you do the lab quiz next week. Now, if you've done all this stuff ahead of time, the lab quiz shouldn't take you more than about 15 to 20 minutes, which is fine. But the thing is that then you have to set up for using your actual microcontroller for the following week on week three. Now, octal is base 8, which means 2 to 3 is 8, and that means we're going to be grouping in groups of 3 starting at the right. And we're going to be writing in weighting factors 1, 2, 4, 1, 2, 4, and 1, 2. And you might be asking, why are these weighting factors? Well, with 1, 2, and 4, you can make any digit from 0 to 7. And that's what base 8 has, just digits 0 to 7. And in this case, what we're going to have is this is a 2. Ooh, that's not a 2. This is a 4. That's a 4. And 4 and 2 is 6. Well, you just circle it because on your lab quiz, it's going to say, is this one of the ones that are wrong? But hex is 2 to the 4, which is 16, which means we're going to be grouping in units of 4, which is 1, 2, 4, 8. 1, 2, 4, 8, and that splits them down right down the middle like this. Now you have to remember that 0 to 9 in decimal here is the same in hex of 0 to 9. But then 10 here is A, 11 is B, and finally 15 is an F. This is 8 and 2, which is 10. 10 is A. That's A. 4 and 2 is 6. Hex version here is perfectly fine. So you're not going to circle the A6. It's great. And let's do the second one just as a quick example. So this should be 2, 5, 4. So that's fine. And so the second one here should be AC. So that's fine. So there's no errors there. So this is the kind of thing that you're going to be doing is grouping and making sure that any of these things that are wrong in octal or hex are circled by you. And then when you get to the lab quiz, it's going to say, is this the pattern of things that are wrong, or is that the pattern of things that are wrong, and so forth. So this is correct. So when you redo this, is this 2? 4-6, and I think you can see it is. Using those weighting factors, I think you can see that this is A6, and that's fine. So you're not going to be circling anything on the top row. Next week in this very same class, right at the start, you're going to have a lab quiz. And the lab quiz is going to be based on you taking a look at what you filled in lab one and comparing it to what it's giving you on the test. There's no handing in of any paper or anything. You're just going to do the lab. You got the printed paper there. And when you do the test, it's going to be multiple choice based on, are these the things that are wrong? It may have a question where it says, maybe this is wrong, that's wrong, and that's wrong is one option. If that's what you've got written down on your sheet, then you say, yes, that's true. This one's wrong. But it might say, this is wrong. So it's going to give you options that this is option A, option B, option C, option D, and you're going to have to match that up with what you've actually written on your sheet to say, yeah, that's what I got. And there's also going to be a none of the above. So, you know, it's a multiple choice. By filling this in and comparing it to what the multiple choice is, you're going to pick the one that you got. So there's no physical handing in of anything. All the stuff is going to be marked online. All the stuff here is correct in the hex. You have to figure out whatever. So going back in hex, you're going to take a look here. And is this the pattern for A6? Yes, so you're not going to circle that. Then you can redo this again. Is this one 2, 4, 6? Yes, so you're not going to circle, you don't circle this. So there's nothing on the first row that you're going to do. But you're going to go through every one of these and make sure that everything is correct, and anything that isn't, you're going to circle. So there's your ASCII chart there. What you're going to find is that you have to fill in a message. So I'll give you a hint as to the first few letters here. This is going to be a capital letter Y when you look it up, 59, because these are in hex. You have to look at the yellow. And this is a small letter O, this is a small letter U, and this is a space which you can show this way. And so you're going to figure out the rest of the message and write it in. And when you get to the quiz, it's going to say, is this the message? So if you haven't filled it in, you're just guessing, right? And down here, you're going to go back the other way. Capital A is a 41, and then you've got a space here, and a space here. So again, you're going to put in the hex numbers for this, including the question mark here. And then it's going to say, is this the same as what you got? And if it is, you say yes. And if it isn't, you say no. Is that anything in bold is correct, and you have to check all the other numbers against this. You need to know how to convert hex to binary to octal, which we just did in question 1A, B, and C. But we haven't done decimal or BCD, so we're going to do that next. If I give you A9, is this A9? Otherwise, circle. And I think it's right. And then when you have this, is this 2, 5, 1? Looks okay. So you're just going to circle the ones that are not correct. But as I said, the ones in bold are correct, so you don't have to circle anything in bold. You just have to circle the things that are not bold if they're incorrect. So you should be able to do at this point the hex, binary, and the octal. But how do I go from here, which is my decimal, to something else? So hex, as we said, is base 16. So you can get it very quickly by dividing 16 into 122. 16 goes into 122, 7, 6 is 42, 111. So this becomes 10. Now this is our first leftmost hex digit, and the remainder, 10, becomes A. So we've just taken 122 and converted and got 7A, so that is indeed correct. Quotient is the first digit, and the remainder is the second digit. And then once you've got this, then you can say, okay, well, 7A is correct now. Is this 7A? Is that 172? You're good. But then you're looking at, what the heck is this BCD? BCD stands for binary coded decimal. Every decimal digit here is coded up as 4-bit binary. So the 1 is 0001, yes. Is the 2 is 0010, yes. Is this 2 here 0010, yes. So BCD works. So what you're going to find is there seems to be patterns that go between binary hex and octal, just regrouping, and decimal to BCD in groups of 4. So the only real calculation you really have to do is going here from decimal to hex and hex to decimal. So we've got A9 here that we have to work on. So that is correct. And this is 16 to the zeros place, which means the ones place. This is a 16 to the ones or the 16s place. This is 10 16s, which is 160, plus 9 ones, which gives you 169. So this number here is indeed correct. So to go from decimal to hex, you divide by 16, quotient is the first digit, remainder is the second. Going back the other way, you multiply this by 16 and add this to get this number here. So the videos will take you through this, and unsigned conversions are the easiest conversions to do. We're going to do this addition, and I'm going to do it on a separate page. 1001 1010. Now, if we convert this to hex, I think you'll find that that is a 9A. 8 and 1 is our 9, 8 and 2 is 10, which is A. So that's our first number. So it's a lot easier to do these calculations in hex than it is in binary. And this is a plus 1111 0110. This should come up as F6. Break it into two parts here and do this as a decimal calculation. A, you know, is 10. This is 6. This is 16 base 10. If you convert that by dividing 16 into 16, you're going to get 1, 0. So the equivalent here is 1, 0 base 16. That's your answer. Now what do? The 0 goes here, and the 1 carries to the next column. So you got 1 plus 9 plus 15. That's 25 base 10. And if you divide 16 into that, 25, you're going to get 1, 9. So that's 1, 9. So the 1 goes here, and the 9 goes there. Because this is extra bit is called a carry. This is your 8-bit result here, and you've got an extra ninth bit. Now, to write this back, you would write 9, 0, and then show the carry here. As far as NZVC goes here, N is always the most significant bit of your result. So in this case, N is a 1. Then there's Z. Z is very simple. Z is 0 means not a 0 result. You've got 256 numbers. Only 0 is 0. So Z equals 1 means the result is 0. So only one chance out of 256 is it going to be 0. Now this number is 90, which is not 0. So this is saying 90 is not 0. Only 0 is 0. And this bit here is our carry, and if we get that extra digit, that puts the 1 here. The thing is with Z is that Z is a special bit. Now, when you take a look at your programming 1, you returned 0, because 0 is all important. The logic levels in C programming are 0 and not 0. As far as programming in C, if you have a 5, that's not 0, so that's a positive logic. You don't have to just have 1 and 0, it's any number in 0. So 0 is the only special one. Plus 0, you never launch missiles at 5, 4, 3, 2, or 1, you launch it at 0. Countdown timers that set up your alarm clock and go beep, beep, beep in the morning to wake you up, when they hit 0, that's the important thing. So Z equals 1 means the result is 0, so 0, 0, Z equals 1. For all the numbers 0, 1, and hex up to FF, here, Z equals 0. These are not 0. This is 0. It's special. This is 9A plus F6. This becomes 10. This is 6. So in base 10, this is 16 base 10. But we want this in hex. So we have to convert the 16 to a hex value, which I think you can see is 10 base 16. 16 goes into 16 once with zero remainder. So this is our first digit. The remainder is the second digit. Now, what do we do with this? The 0 goes here, and the 1 carries to the next column. And then we say add 1 plus 9 plus 15 to get 25, which is the addition of these in decimal, which is base 10. And then we can divide 16 into 25. Once with 9 remainder. So the 1 here becomes our carry, which is this guy. And the 9 goes here, and then we just write that back into there. If you consider these to be signed numbers, this says this number is negative because the most significant bit is a 1. So the 1 means true, the 0 means false. So this says it is negative, it's not 0, and I got what we call an unsigned overflow, or C equals 1. Now what we want to do is convert this to hex. And again, let's see if we can break this into two. And this is 1, 2, 4, 8, 1, 2, 4, 8. So I think you'll see this is the same thing as 5B subtract EA. Let's take a look in decimal. If we have a number like 52 subtract 28, okay? And this is the only concept you need, and you probably learned this in public school. So in decimal, what do? You borrow 1 from the 5, make this a 4, and you bring over 10 from this column to that, because this column that had the 5 in it is 10 bigger than the column here. So this becomes 1, 2 base 10 minus 8, which is 4. That's our answer there, and we've got our answer. And this is exactly what you need to do for hex subtraction. What you're going to see here is B is 11 and A is 10. So 11 minus 10, that's a 1. That was a hard calculation. But then the problem that you run into is when you have a number that's bigger than the other number, such as E is bigger than 5. And you say, well, what do I do? Well, you go to the bank and you set the carry. This is either carry or when you're subtracting, it's called a borrow. You set it and then you use it. So what you borrow is what you use. So this is how much I'm in debt. There I am using the money. Now this column becomes 1, 5, but it's base 16. 1, 5 base 16 is 16 plus 5 is 21. So this 1, 5 here is 21 decimal minus your E, which is 14, and this gives us a 7. So our answer here is 71. Now, we had to borrow, so this case, when we're subtracting, it's called a borrow, but it's still the C bit. And then we write down 0, 1, 1, 1, and we write down 0, 0, 0, 1. And if we want to look at NZVC, this is our N bit, which is always the most significant bit. That's a 0. This is not 0, it's 71, so this is not 0. So this is not negative, not 0 as a sign number. But we did have to borrow, so this one here is a 1. Now let me show you the hardest one I can ever give you. That's something like 0, 0 minus anything. So this is what I call the Lazy Joe, Hardworking Bob scenario. And this guy here is Lazy Joe, and this is Hardworking Bob. What happens is, Lazy Joe says, Bob, I need to borrow money. And Bob says, I got nothing. I got nothing. You can see I got nothing. So Joe says, Bob, hey, go to the bank. So Bob takes out a loan, and Bob now has $16. He did all that work. He went to the bank, took out a loan, and now he's got $16. He's borrowed $16. He's got $16. Now Lazy Joe says, hey, Bob, you got $16. How would you like to lend me something? So 16 minus 1 is 15, and look who ends up with a $16, Lazy Joe. Lazy Joe has 10 base 16, which is 16 minus the B, which is 11, and there's a 5. 15 minus A is 5. So that's your answer, and that's the hardest one that you can do as a subtraction. We just did this one, and what we got was 71. The N bit here is a 0. This answer is not 0, so this is not negative. This is not 0. And did we have to borrow? Yes, we had to borrow. So these three bits and this answer are correct. A, E, plus C, D. Break it down the middle. This is 14. D is 13. Now this becomes 27 base 10. 16 goes into that 1, 1. So this becomes 1B. There's our 1. There's our B. 1 base 16. The B goes here. The 1 goes and copies to the next column. So this becomes 1 plus 10 plus 12, which is 23 base 10. And to convert back, 16 goes into 23 once and 7. So this becomes 1 and 7. And let's take a look at our NZBC. These in binary, this is 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, all the way to 0, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1. So all this range here from 0 to 7, n is 0. From 8, which is 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, to 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1. All of these in this range here, n equals 1. So digits 0 to 7 as the first digit, like this one, n is 0. Digits 8 through f, n equals 1. It's that simple. So in this case, the 7, that's going to be 0. And this is not 0, and we did get a carry. And you can see here, that our answer is indeed 7B. It's not negative because only the numbers 8, 0 through FF have the most significant bit 1. So the most significant bit of 7 is a 0, so N should be 0. This is something you're going to circle. 7B, which in 7B is definitely not 0, so you don't circle this one. But you did get an extra bit, didn't you? So this is correct. So the N bit is the thing you're going to have to circle here. When we're doing a subtraction, so in this case, E is bigger than D by 1. So, but at this point, what we're going to find is that E is indeed bigger than A, so we can set the carry, and we get 1A here. So what we borrow is what we use. Now, this column here is 16 bigger than this column. So that becomes 1A base 16 minus the C. That's 16 plus 10, which is 26 for this, minus our C, which is 12, which gives us 14, which is E. N is 1 or 0. Well, think about it. 0 through 7 is, N is 0, so this is a 1. And Z, E1 is not 0, and in this case, because this is bigger, we had to borrow, and that's also a C. Now let's take a look at doing some very simple calculations. Let's try taking a look at a number like FF plus 1, 0, 0 plus a carry, okay? So that means that if I start with all the money in the universe and somebody gives me another dollar, I got $0. If I say A equals 0x FF, and I say B equals 0x 01, and I say C equals A plus B, I think you'll understand that this is all that C can handle. It cannot handle that extra bit. That bit goes into the carry. And what that carry is saying, that C equals 1, is saying this is a unsigned overflow. I start with $255, I get another dollar, I got nothing. That makes no sense. So you've overflowed your number system by going over the end. Anytime the carry is set, that means that this is an unsigned overflow and the result is not valid. 03 subtract 05. That means I go 3 units this way, and then I go 5 units this way, and I'm going to come back on this side here. So 5 is bigger than 3, so we have to borrow from here, but there's nothing to borrow. So this is a Lazy Joe thing again. So poor old Bob, he has to take out a loan. He's got $16. Then he loses one of those to Lazy Joe. Lazy Joe has 1-3 base 16, which is 19 minus 5, which is 14, and that becomes E. And then we have our F here. And that's exactly what he's going to do, because there's FE up here, isn't it? So anytime the carry is set, that means the result is not valid in our unsigned line. And that's why the C bit is referred to as the unsigned overflow. Unsigned numbers, whether they're char, short, long, or long, char 8 bits, short is 16 bits, long is 32, and long is 64, an integer is not fixed. If you remember doing PRG, remember you said Windows 32 when you did programming with Visual Studio, and then your integers were 32-bit. If you switched to Windows 64, it was now integers were 64-bit. So integers are not a fixed length. They depend on your data bus rating. Chars are always 8-bit, shorts are always 16, long are always 32, and longs are always 64. So these are your standards here. All numbers are considered positive. M has no meaning. Signed numbers, half the numbers are positive, half are negative. But this is where we're getting into unsigned overflow here. If you add two chars together and get, which are 8-bit numbers, and get a 9th bit, or you add two shorts, which are two 16-bit numbers, get a 17th bit, or and so on, then you have C equals 1, which means that's an unsigned overflow, which means your number system can't handle it. Or if you subtract a larger number from a smaller number, because when you do, you get a negative. If I have FF plus 1, I get 0, 0, plus a carry, and this carry is saying the result is not valid here. But let's take a look here. FF is negative 1. Adding 1 gives me 0. It's perfectly good. 7F plus 1. If we do, that's 8, 0, plus no carry. And up here, 7F plus 1, 8, 0 is perfect, and this 0 is saying it's a valid result unsigned. However, what happens when we look at that in terms of a signed interpretation? I started with all the money in the universe, I got another dollar, and now I'm as far dead as I can possibly go. Well, 7F happens to be a positive, 1 is a positive, and if you add two positives, you should get a, this is your signed overflow. If you add two positives, you should get a positive, and if you don't, that means you've gone over the positive end and wrapped around to the negative end, and that is a signed overflow where V equals 1. So if you add two positives and get a negative, or add two negatives and get a positive, let's try the negatives. Let's try 80 plus FF. I'll do the calculation for you. This is 7F plus a carry, which means this is a negative plus a negative, and strangely enough, we got a positive. And that means I started as far in debt as I could go, I went one more dollar in debt, and I've got all the money in the universe. And in this case, V equals 1. This is a signed overflow. If you add two negatives and get a positive, or add two positives and get a negative, that is your problem. So these two different number systems have different types of overflows. So a signed overflow occurs if you add two numbers of the same sign and get an answer of the opposite sign. And that has to do with the signed number system. Unsigned only works in the unsigned chars, the unsigned shorts, and so on. Signed overflows only work with the signed chars, the signed shorts, and all that kind of stuff. So that's the kind of stuff that you're going to be looking at here. So this one here is a negative. A is 1010, so that's a negative. 1100, so that's a negative. And this is a positive. So we're adding a negative to a negative, and we're getting a positive. So B should be 1. Notice this one, this is a negative, because it's in the range 8, 9, A, B, C, D, E, F. It's a negative plus a positive. And you're asking yourself, well, can I get a signed overflow by adding numbers of opposite sign? And the answer is, no, you cannot. So in this case here, if you add a positive, that means you're going in this direction. And if you add a negative to that, you're going back in this direction. So positive plus a negative, V is going to be 0, because you can't go over either bounds. If you have a negative plus a positive, you can't pick two numbers that are going to go over that. So again, V is 0. V equals 0 if you add numbers of opposite sign. Only if you add numbers of the same sign and get an opposite sign. So if I have something like 5 subtract 3 in decimal, you can write this as 5 subtract positive 3, or you can write it as 5 plus negative 3. So because the rule says that if you add two numbers, but if you have a subtraction, you can convert that subtraction into an addition here by just changing the sign of the number you're subtracting. So if I do something like 9a minus 6, F. So let's do the calculation. So F is bigger than A, so we have to borrow one from that. That's an 8, that's a 1A. 1A base 16 is 16 plus 10 is 26 minus 15 is going to give us 11, and 11 is B. 8 minus 6 is 2, and we got 0 here, right? So the concept is that N here, Z here, V here, and C here. Well, obviously C is 0 because this number here, 9A, was bigger than 6F. The 2 is not negative because it's in the range of 0 to 7, so N is 0. So this is not a negative number as a sign number because 2B is somewhere up in here, right? And it's not 0. Let's take a look at figuring out the V bit. So this is a negative here for 9A, and we're subtracting 6A, which is a positive. Now, if we want to write that in terms of an addition, a negative subtract a positive is the same thing as a negative plus, and then changing the other sign, a negative, and we got a positive here, so this case V is 1. So you just have to rethink it. This is a negative subtract a positive, which is like a negative plus the opposite of the positive, which is a negative plus a negative, and our answer here is positive, and therefore V is 1. Basically, you should be able to figure out which things are wrong here in the not highlighted stuff, and hex and binary, what's wrong here, what's wrong in binary and octal, be able to write out this message, be able to write this out in hex. Right now, you should be able to, and with your calculator, you can figure out what this is, but then you're going to have to say, well, is 7B, is it negative? No, it's positive, and circle these. And when you get down to here, you're going to have to convert these to hex, then you can do them on your calculator, convert back, whatever. But in this case, let's look at this one. This one here is a positive, subtract a negative, right? This is a positive, it's very easy to spot here, minus a negative, so it's positive minus negative, we're saying it's positive plus a positive, giving us a positive, so the V bit is 0. This one here is a negative, subtract a positive, which is the same thing as a negative plus a negative, and we got a positive, so V should be 1. So at this point, you should be able to do everything down, including all the questions down to question 5, and that's the first half of our lab.